Hey all, Siksha here. Today we will be starting with the next lesson of our chapter transport in plants. That is, in this lesson we will be talking about the long distance transport of water. So first we will be seeing a brief introduction about the lesson. Then we will be talking about the absorption of water followed by its movement up a plant. So let's start with the lesson. Now our NCRT says that long distance transport cannot occur by diffusion since it is a slow process. Like, the data that NCRT has given is that the movement of a substance via diffusion up to 50 micrometer takes in 2.5 seconds. So that's a very, very slow process. In that pace, if you are to transport substances, it would take some days for a leaf, that the food that's synthesized by leaf, to reach to the roots. So that's how the diffusion cannot work. So for that purpose, the water, the minerals and the food are generally moved by a mass or a bulk flow system. Now, what is this new type of system that we are studying about? The mass or the bulk flow is the movement of substances from one point to another as a result of pressure difference between these two points. As I've already told you, this pressure gradient plays a major role. So, this pressure difference is either created in the plant or it is already present. So, how this pressure difference can be achieved? It can be achieved either by a positive pressure or a negative pressure gradient. Now, one thing you should remember, if we are talking about a positive pressure gradient, we are creating a high pressure in that area. Like, you are, you know, creating conditions that are leading to a high pressure in that region. If we talk of a negative pressure, we are creating a low pressure in that region that leads to the extracting of substances from high pressure area. If you are talking about the positive hydrostatic pressure, we are creating a high pressure that leads to movement of substances to a low pressure area. And this whole, you know, movement of substances in bulk through the conductance system is known as translocation. So when we are talking of substances that are in transit in the plant, we are basically talking of translocation of those things in the plant. Now, absorption of water in plants takes place by root and root hairs. You know that there are two distinct pathways through which the absorption takes place. That is, one is apoplast and the other is symplast. If we talk of apoplast, that takes place through the intercellular spaces or through the cell walls, and it does not involve crossing the cells. It does not go into the cells or by cytoplasmic streaming or anything. It just moves up through the spaces that are present in between the cells. And this movement completely depends on gradient, and this movement is by mass flow, which occurs due to the adhesive and cohesive properties of water. Now, what are these adhesive and cohesive properties of water? That you will know in the next lesson. For now, you should know that cohesive property of water is the attraction between the water molecules, and the adhesive properties means the attraction of water molecules to the polar surfaces like your tracheary elements. Now, if we talk of symplast pathway, the symplast pathway is a system of interconnected protoplast where the substance is actually moving through the cells via cytoplasmic strands, which is also known as plasmodesmata. Plasmodesmata are connecting things between the cells, and which are basically, what are plasmodesmata? Basically, these are cytoplasmic strands. And water travels through these cells, and movement is relatively slower because there is, there in apoplast, the substances were moving in the free space, because cortical region initially has a lot of free space, the cells are loosely bound. From there, apoplast takes place. But in symplast, the movement is relatively slower because water has to cross each and every cell. But one thing that is common to apoplast is that in symplast also, the movement is dependent on gradient. Now, if we talk as a whole, the initial absorption in root and movement of water is by apoplast. Initially, apoplast takes place. Because I told you earlier, cortical cells are very loose, so they have a lot of intercellular spaces, water can easily move up there. But when it comes to endodermis, it provides a resistance to apoplast. Now, there are two reasons why there is a resistance to apoplast. First is the parenchymal cells over the endodermis are very tightly packed. They don't have much intercellular space. And the second major important reason is that there is a band of suberized matrix called Casparian strips, which are water repellent in nature. Suberized matrix means a thick patch or a thick lining of suberin, which is a water repellent pigment or a substance, you can say, thick substance that does not allow water to go through it. Now, not all of endodermis is covered. Some parts of the endodermis is covered with this and some parts are left free. So since there is such hindrance here, the water does not move by apoplast. Water movement of molecules are unable to penetrate this layer, so they are directed to non-superized regions where superin is not present, and there they pass anatomies via symplast, not by apoplast, because there is less intercellular space. The movement of water by through root layers is ultimately symplastic. This is a very important point you should remember. And there is a diagram given in your NCRT. You can see I have put up that. Before that, you can see I have put one point. After entering the xylem, the movement is apoplast. Like in the beginning, there is apoplast movement. See, when it enters the epidermis, there is the apoplast movement, and there again is a symplast movement. Here is the key. See, this is the symplast and this is the apoplast. The dark brown is for apoplast and the light brown is for symplast. From epidermis to cortex, when it moves again, there is movement via symplast and apoplast. But when it comes from cortex to endodermis, the movement is ultimately the symplastic movement. You can see everywhere the water is entering into the cell. Again, from endodermis to pericycle also the movement is symplastic, but when it comes from pericycle to xylem, from xylem again the movement becomes apoplast, because the water has to move fast in the cell. Now there are some special structures which are associated with the absorption of water and mineral nutrients in plants. Not all plants require them, but certainly there are some plants which cannot absorb all water and minerals on their own, and they are dependent on certain other living organisms. One of them is a fungus which helps plants in absorption of water and minerals, and the symbiotic association of fungus with the root system is known as mycorrhiza. Mycorrhiza is specifically mentioned in NCRT, so we will be talking about that. What is mycorrhiza basically? The fungal filaments are there which have formed a network around the root, and they penetrate into the root cells. And how do they help? They have a very large surface area which absorb more mineral ions and waters, and helps the plant to absorb more water and mineral. Now since it is a symbiotic association, in return the mycorrhiza gets sugar and nitrogen containing compounds from the roots. And an example for the mycorrhiza is pinus tree of gymnosperm species has mycorrhiza. We'll move on to the next part, that is we'll be talking about the movement of water upper plant. Now in this water movement, there are many ways by which water moves up in a plant, but in our NCRT only two pathways are mentioned. One is the root pressure and the other is the transpirational pull. We will be talking about the transpiration in the next lesson. In this lesson, we will be talking basically of the root pressure. Now what happens is that this root pressure takes place when absorption is high and transpiration is low. That leads to a positive pressure developed in the xylem due to increase in water potential. Now when in early morning or late night, when there is a cool humid atmosphere and transpiration is very low, and still the plant keeps on absorbing water, the water accumulates in the root. So what happens as in a result of that accumulation is that the water potential increases in that area, and there's a positive or high pressure region is created in that root, which leads to the pushing of water to up to small distances. This is known as root pressure, and this pushes only up to small distances. As an effect of root pressure, there is a certain phenomenon called as guttation. This is known as an effect of root pressure because since water keeps on accumulating and it cannot be transpired, water moves out of the plant by guttation. What is guttation? You don't need to know much in detail in this lesson. Not much detail has been given. All you need to know is that guttation is the loss of liquid droplets in the plants that occurs to the hydrophores, or the pores that are present at the margin of the leaves, in the time when there is low transpiration, on where this absorption is high and transpiration is low. So that is the effect of root pressure. And how does root pressure help? Basically, root pressure cannot push the water up to large distances, that we have already read. But the other way it helps is that when transpiration takes place, there is an enormous tension created. The enormous pull that is caused by the transpiration leads to the breaking of the chains of the water molecules that are present in the tracheal elements. So to re-establish or to reconnect that chains of water molecules, root pressure takes a very important role. It helps in joining the chains of the molecule because it keeps on pushing the water molecules up the plant. So that is how root pressure establishes its own importance. So that's all for now. We'll be reading the next part in the next lesson. So I hope you liked it. Thank you.